Well, good day, church. I'm so glad that I get to stand here and bring you God's word. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Brett France, and this is my last sermon, actually, as the Sunday service director. As of the 1st of Jan, I get to be the next gen pastor, which I'm so excited about. And we were joking before I started preaching that because I'm not a pastor yet, you have to be very kind to this message. But next week, when I bring God's word again on the 3rd of December, then I'm held to a higher standard because I am a pastor. But yeah, church, I just thank you so much for being with us through this journey. And I'm really excited that I get to bring you God's word today. Again, like I said, I have the privilege of rounding out the year. So looking back at 2020 and then also looking forward into 2021 on the 3rd of December. And now Richard made a joke about I should title my series called Tenet. And now I haven't seen the movie. It's the new, Christopher Nolan film. And so all those nerds, sorry, Richard, I'm calling you a nerd, but all those movie fanatics out there, if you've watched the movie and you really think as we look forward and look back at the same time almost, if Tenet is a good title for this sermon series, maybe just comment it in the notes. You'll make Richard a very happy man. But no, I've titled this series Wherever You Look. And we'll be using Daniel chapter 7 as our text for both this week's sermon and next week's sermon. Now, Daniel 7 is such an interesting chapter in the Bible. You see, the first seven chapters of Daniel are written in Aramaic, which is the sister language to Hebrew. Most of the Old Testament is written in Hebrew, so it's just a fascinating little difference. And also, Daniel is writing this in captivity under the Babylonians. And it's a well-known Bible. If you went to Sunday school, it's a well-known book of the Bible. You know, if you went to Sunday school as a lighty, you probably would have heard of Daniel in the lion's den, Daniel and his friends in the furnace. And it's just a beautiful book. And it's so much of this book is made up of a certain type of literature that we find in our Bible. And it's called apocalyptic literature. Now, when I say this, apocalyptic, probably what comes to mind is the apocalypse, the end of the world, nuclear fallout, zombies, World War III, that sort of thing. And while this is definitely not an incorrect view of how apocalyptic literature works, it's actually so much broader than that. You see, simply put, apocalyptic literature is a genre and a literature style of prophecies speaking to the end of times. And so a lot of Daniel was found in that. And what's so interesting about apocalyptic literature, guys, really, I want to encourage you to read your Bibles. It's so fascinating. What's so fascinating about apocalyptic literature is it's not just meant to be understood and read and known, but it also uses lots of imagery. It's meant to be felt and really not just up here, but it sinks into here as you read and enjoy the scripture. There's so many images of different things and beasts and oceans and things that are out of this world. It's amazing that what is in our Bible is just so, so beautiful. And so that's a little bit around what chapter 7 that we're going to be looking through today. So what I'm really excited for is that we will walk away from this text understanding it a bit better, because often it's a text we shy away from, this type of genre. But also not just understanding it better, but really feeling the word of God. So let's get into the word. Won't you tap or turn with me to Daniel chapter 7? It's towards the end of your Old Testament. If you have the Bible in front of you, it's just after the book of Ezekiel. And so you can keep your Bibles open because we're going to go covering quite a bit of text. And there's a lot of really wild and exciting things in here. And I want you to make sure while it's on the screen that I'm also not making it up. All right. So please do follow with us. So before we read the opening verses, here's a roadmap to the chapter. This chapter is all about a dream that Daniel has, that God gives him at night. And Daniel wakes up and he writes down his dream. And so the roadmap for this chapter is this, that there's this storm and sea, and out of the sea, these four beasts rise up. And then these four beasts are judged by the Ancient of Days. And then we see Jesus coming on clouds. And then Daniel's looking at this dream and thinking, what is going on? And so he turns to an angel in the dream and says, help me understand. And so the angel explains to him all the different symbolisms of the dream. And that's how Daniel chapter 7 ends. And so we're going to be dealing with the beast and God in today's sermon. Or the beast, the four beasts and God in the sermon. So for Daniel's dream, I need you to picture with me the beach. If you've ever been, I'm sure you'll have a picture in your mind, but if you've never been to the beach, that's okay. I'm sure you've probably seen a movie about it, or you've on social media seen all your friends enjoying their lovely beach holidays right now except for those people in the garden route. I'm really sorry about that. Maybe it's too soon, but that's for another time. Anyways, what you remember or what you might have seen is these long sandy beaches with beautiful blue sky that goes on forever, warm, hot, almost golden sunshine coming down on people. And really, it's just an all-round amazing time. So picture that. Now, I've been fortunate enough to head down to the beach for some December holidays quite often. And I love the beach. I love just walking down there with my towel onto that soft sand. It's a bit hot, so you kind of like walk quickly, go find a little bit further down close to the water where the sand isn't so hot. You lay your towel down. You put that umbrella in to create some shade, and then it's a beautiful dance between tanning in the sun and back to the shade, tanning to the sun, back to the shade, and then being maybe too hot. So you go to this beautiful crystal clear water, these gentle rolling waves. If you're maybe a good enough swimmer, you'll try to catch some waves. If you can surf, I've tried a couple of times, it's not so good. But if you can surf, maybe you'll stand up and catch some beautiful waves. Ah. You can tell I'm missing the beach. I'm so glad I'm here, but I also kind of wish I was down at the beach right now. And so I want you to have that picture in your mind. Now, that's one side of the coin of the ocean and the beach. We want to flip that coin around and have a look at another side. You see, when there is wind, when there is chaos, when there is a storm down at the beach, this is not the picture that we come to know and love. Actually, it's quite a terrifying experience. The winds can be ferocious. The ocean is a powerful beast that can't be tamed. And when the winds pick up and the waves swell, sometimes they swell so big and the wind is so powerful that the water at the top of the waves gets blown off the top of the wave. And as you look out at the ocean, you just see not so much blue, but more white as the wind is just blowing and blowing in these massive swells. And picture with me dark clouds just hanging low over the ocean. It almost looks as if the clouds might touch the sea. And in that place, the ocean becomes ferocious and untamable and terrifying. Now, what I want you to do is picture this as we read together from the book of Daniel. Now, hold that picture in your mind. In the first year of Belshazzar, king of In the first year of Belshazzar, king of Babylon, Daniel had a dream, and visions passed through his mind as he was lying in bed. He wrote down the substance of his dream. Daniel said, "In my vision at night, I looked, and there before me were the four winds of heaven churning up the great sea. Four great beasts, each different from the others, came up out of the sea." Now, what I want you to know that is these four beasts are linked to some of great imagery that we've come to know, and we include in eschatological discussions, all those long words. But these beasts are infamous. And in fact, these beasts are linked to a dream that King Nebuchadnezzar had back in verse 2. And you'll even remember Ryan's sermon from last week. We had a look at King Nebuchadnezzar and just the life and the humiliation that he went through. And so I want you to keep reading with me as we go on from these beasts. So in verse 4, the first beast comes. "The first was like a lion, and it had the wings of an eagle. I watched until its wings were torn off, and it was lifted from the ground so that it stood on 2 feet like a human being, and the mind of a human was given to it." Now, what does this mean? Well, the scholars all agree that this first beast is describing the empire of Babylon. And King Nebuchadnezzar actually, in fact, Jeremiah refers to him as a lion and an eagle. And so they've come to agree that this refers to the Babylonian Empire. And that when we see that his wings are being torn off, that's the humiliation that King Nebuchadnezzar went through that we read about with Ryan last week. Now I want you to read with me as we get to the second beast. Verse 5. "And there before me was a second beast, which looked like a bear. It was raised up on one of its sides, and it had three ribs in its mouth between its teeth. It was told, 'Get up and eat your full of flesh.'" Now, what does this one mean? This beast is often referred to as the Medo-Persian Empire. It's the empire that came after the Babylonians that took over the known world at that point. And again, the scholars will talk around what the different elements mean. He was raised up on one side. That could mean that the Persians were stronger than the Medes, and the Persians overtook from the Medes and then overtook the rest of the known world. And the three ribs in its mouth, you know, that could mean a whole host of different things, the different leaders of the empire at that time. But again, the scholars agree this refers to the empire of the Medo-Persians. Then have a look with me at verse 6. After that, Daniel says, I looked, and there before me was another beast, one that looked like a leopard, and on its back it had four wings, like those of a bird. This beast had four heads, and it was given authority to rule. All right, so now this one, the scholars will say, is the Greek Empire, led by Alexander the Great. And why they say that is because a leopard is known for its agility, and this kingdom, or this empire, took over the world with great agility. And not only even agility, but also speed. The wings on this leopard's back represent the speed of just how quickly, at 31, Alexander the Great ruled the known world, and they took over from the Persians. Next up after that, we get to verse 7, and read with me here. After that, in my vision at night, I looked, and there before me was a fourth beast, terrifying and frightening and very powerful. It had large iron teeth. It crushed and devoured its victims and trampled underfoot whatever was left. It was different from all the former beasts, and it had 10 horns. While I was looking about the horns, there before me was another horn, a little one, which came up among them, and three of the first horns were uprooted before it. This horn had eyes like the eyes of a human being, and a mouth that spoke boastfully. This last beast, this last description, is so terrifying that in fact it isn't even compared to an animal. It's got these teeth that are made of steel, and it crushes anything before it. And it's got, the scholars would say, it's got 10 horns. So that's 5 times the normal amount of horns on animals. It shows that this empire is 5 times stronger than anything that came before it, and 5 times will last longer. And so when we look at the Roman Empire, that's exactly what we see. This terrifying empire that crushed all before it and lasted for years upon years upon years. In fact, actually, church, what I would love for you to draw out for you is that in this Roman Empire, Jesus died under this empire. And in this Roman Empire, King Nero, it's told that he would light roads with the burning bodies of Christians. Christians suffered greatly under this Roman Empire. So no wonder it's the most terrifying beast of all. These four beasts are terrifying, but none as terrifying as the fourth. Now, what I want you to remember is that in that chaotic ocean I described earlier, the beasts rose up out of that ocean. But did you notice that in verse 2, the winds that were coming from the corners of heaven? A commentator helped me see that what this means is that the very winds amidst the chaos, well, they were controlled by God. God controls these winds because they come from the four corners of heaven. They are his winds coming from heaven. And so all of this picture describes a scene of chaos and terrifying. And we, like I said, in this kind of literature, we're meant to feel it and almost be afraid at what's going on here. But it can seem quite confusing. So what on earth does this kind of scripture have for us today? I mean, what does ancient apocalyptic scripture really mean today? So I listened to a sermon by David, I've got a good friend called David Jones. Shout out if you're watching. But by Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones. He's a great English preacher of the 1950s. And in his sermon, he said this: how can we, as a modern population, believe that this is relevant to us today? And so I want to ask the same question, really, in even a more modern era. How on earth is this kind of text relevant to us today? And Martin, Dr. Lloyd-Jones's defense was this: this is the word of God, and it is just as relevant as every other part of scripture that we'll come to. And so my hope for us today is that God will help illuminate his word for us. It will come here, but it will also sink here, and we may feel it. In fact, I just want to pray for us really quickly for God's word. Almighty Father, we are so, so grateful that we have this word in front of us. We are so grateful, God, that You have made yourself known through your word and through the coming of your son, Jesus Christ. And so I pray, God, that you would help us understand the scripture today. We pray this in your name, Lord. Amen. Thank you, church. So I've already described to you what the scholars seem to all agree around what these four beasts represent. Right? First, the Babylonian Empire, that was beast one, then into the Medo-Persian Empire, then into the Greek Empire, and finally the Roman Empire. So, like I said, what does this mean for us today? Well, Dr. Lloyd-Jones, about 70 years ago, asking the same question. Again, we are asking it. And so we're going to discover today why this is relevant to us. So, Lord, you're speaking. What are you saying? Now, I agree with the scholars in terms of the specifics of this text, right? They are learned people. They've studied this for years and years. I'm not here to try and figure out maybe the beast means something different. No, no, no. I do believe and trust what they're saying. But I believe this text shows us so much more about what is generally going on in the world. As we take us maybe a step back from the scene and not try and understand each four beasts, but understand the chaos and the beast as a whole. It shows us, I believe, that we are not in control. Empires rise and empires fall. And try as we might, we cannot control the world around us. And sometimes when we are experiencing a particular beast, either personally or something we as a collective are facing, something that feels so out of our control, we might feel hopeless. We may feel that we will never escape this awful time. We may feel like we are in the ocean being pulled and tossed and churned by these winds. I mean, simply look at the year we've had. 2020, a year we cannot forget, try as we might. A year that for many of us was full of anxiety, disappointment, grief, depression, fear, loss, sadness. You see, I wouldn't consider myself an anxious person. I don't get anxious. But I have experienced anxiety this year in ways that I'm only really beginning to understand now, both at work and at home. It's been an anxious year for me. At work, to be honest, church, getting this kind of studio and stuff set up was one of the most anxious times of my life. We had this really tight deadline. We had to go from recording in the auditorium one day to getting everything into the studio so we could be live for you the very next Sunday. Because the thing with church work, what I'm realizing is every week, Sunday's coming, and every week we've got to be ready for game day. And so that brought a lot of anxiety onto me, and I felt the weight of all of you out there getting church. While I wasn't the one planning the sermons or planning the service order, I felt the weight of, if I don't get this tech to work, no one is going to get church. And again, I think I put more weight on my shoulders than I really needed to. We've got such an amazing staff here. We've got the likes of Phil, who is just a wizard and knows all the things. We've got legends like James and Candace and Riz and Christine. And so there wasn't that much weight on my shoulders, but I put it on myself. And yet God came through for me and for us. And yet it was such an anxious period in my life. Then another anxious period was, okay, we're going back to in-person, but we're going to keep online going. And all of a sudden we've doubled what we do on a Sunday, but we haven't doubled the amount of people we have to make it happen. And so another anxious thing. And on top of that, how do we keep people safe as they gather for church? How do we keep this virus away as we worship God? A lot of anxiety. And then as we go to home, even at home, I was fearful of the virus, fearful that I might give it to a loved one who may not be as healthy as I, fearful that if I pass this virus on to loved ones, I would be the reason of someone's death. Anxiety and fear, that was the storm of my 2020. What has been the rough storm of your 2020, church? Maybe it was loss. Lost loved ones, lost experiences, lost income. 2020 will go down as the year everyone lost something. Maybe you didn't even lose to that extent, but you may have lost your sense of security, your sense of being in control, your sense of certainty. Everyone lost something this year. Maybe you couldn't celebrate some big birthdays. Maybe you couldn't celebrate big markers in your life. Maybe you missed out on your matric dance, that final sports game, the final production of your school. Maybe you missed out first year on campus, even your last year on campus. Maybe you had to graduate over Zoom. I mean, that's awful, and I'm really sorry if that was 4 years of hard work into graduating on a computer screen. Maybe 2020 will go down as the year of you're on mute. 2020 has been a year, but if we lift our eyes even from the pandemic and we look around, we see the massive explosion in Beirut, massive social unrest in America, forest fires in Australia and California, swarms of locusts of biblical proportions in North Africa and the Middle East, the Ukrainian airliner that was shut down. Things we may have even forgotten because of the pandemic. Sadly, church, I could go on and on about how tough this year has been. This year has been a storm for all of us. And from the storm, beasts have come out of it. Maybe 2020 has been your beast. Or as we read in the verse, as we were reading through the different beasts of Daniel's dream, maybe another beast came to the forefront of your mind, a beast that wasn't this year, or something that came out of this year. Because you see, the overarching imagery, why this is important and relevant for us today, the overarching imagery of this dream is showing the chaos of the world, the turmoil that our world finds itself in, a world separated from God, and the hurt and sin and shame that is in that world. These awful beasts represent a world apart from God and the chaos that a world like that ensues. But we have an awesome God, and all hope is not lost. You see, I want to encourage you today, church family. There is one who controls the winds of the storm. There is one who is mightier than the beasts of this world. There is someone greater than the beasts of Daniel's dream, who is greater than the empires of ancient history. And Daniel is about to introduce us to him. Look at me in your Bibles, and let's read from verse 9. This is what verse 9 through verse 12 say. As I looked, thrones were set in place, and the Ancient of Days took his seat. His clothing was white as snow. The hair of his head was white like wool. His throne was flaming with fire, and its wheels were all ablaze. A river of fire was flowing, coming out from before him. Thousands upon thousands attended him. 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The court was seated, and the books were opened. Then I continued to watch because of the boastful words the horn was speaking. I kept looking until the beast was slain and its body destroyed and thrown into the blazing fire. The other beasts had been stripped of their authority, but were allowed to live for a period of time. All right, church, so what are we going to do is we're going to unpack this a little bit and work through it. So the next thing I want to say is, as I looked, all right, Daniel wants to remind us here of the horrific scenes of verses 2 through 8 were a dream. Those first verses we read, 2 through 8, those were a dream. He's looking onto a dream. He's reminding us of that. I would call it a nightmare, a night terror, if you will, but we're calling it a dream for this. And then he goes on. He sees the Ancient of Days. The Ancient of Days, he takes his seat. The Ancient of Days takes his seat on a throne that was laid out for him. Now, if you have your Bible open in front of you, or maybe you've got it open on a device in front of you, I want to ask you to have a look. There should be a little letter next to the Ancient of Days. It's a little annotation. And what this is, it's a beautiful way for the authors, the translators of the Bible to say there's another place in the Bible where this word or phrase is used. And so if we click on that, or if you have a look what it says in the notes at the bottom, you can page back, I'll read it for us, to Psalm 90, verse 2. And it's a reference here to help us understand the Ancient of Days, the name of this great person in the stream, because Daniel doesn't know yet who it is. And this is what Psalm 90, verse 2 says. Before the mountains were born, or you brought forth the whole world, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. Ancient of Days, that is who Daniel is talking about. That is the same person that I referenced earlier, and it's not a person. That's someone, this person, who is stronger and greater than the beasts of this world. He has a name. He has many names in our wonderful Bible. Here he is the Ancient of Days. Before time, he was. His name is Yahweh. God the Father, our Lord, capital Lord. Yahweh, and read with me. It says, "And he has clothing as white as snow, and the hair of his head white like wool, and a throne flaming with fire." The imagery here is of holiness, wisdom, and power. A river of fire was flowing out before him. And we see that thousands upon thousands attended him, and 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. We have just been introduced to one of the most vivid and full images of our great God. Our Creator, this amazing passage of Scripture is describing to us our God, the Creator. Yahweh, in all his glory and splendor. His name is almost too holy to say. This is who is greater. This who is in control of our world. A commentator explained it to me like this. The scene depicts in powerful imagery a judge who has the wisdom to sort out the right from wrong, the purity to persistently choose the right, and the power to enforce his judgments. This is our God, and he is served by thousands and attended to by millions. This is the Ancient of Days. Church family, this is who we are praying for when we say, Father God. I know he is our Father, and that he can have, and that we can have an intimate and loving relationship with him. And it is good for us to experience God in this way. It is so good for us to feel the nearness of our Father, God our Father. But he is also this Ancient of Days, almighty and pure. Holy, holy, holy is he. When we pray, let us be mindful of who it is we are speaking to. Phrases like Daddy God, Papa, or Daddy might be okay, I think, in a personal place, but in corporate, when we're praying with our fellow brothers and sisters, let's remember who we are talking to. Let's not get too familiar with this Ancient of Days. He is our Father, yes. He's also the head of the Trinity, and he is the Ancient of Days with a river of fire coming out from before him. Church, let us keep our reverence in our prayers and lift our eyes and fall on our face before the mighty God who controls and holds all things in his hands. I find it so interesting actually, in Judaism, out of fear and reverence for God, they go even a step further, and they won't even say or write his full name. See, that's how much weight the name of God carries, because that is who we are talking to. We are calling on the creator of the universe when we say his name. And this wonderful picture from Daniel's dream, displays the glorious wonder of God our Father, the Ancient of Days. Let's keep our reverence when we speak to our awesome God, church. Right, let's get back to the text and have a look at verse 10. Verse ends with this. The court was seated and the books were opened. Court is in session, and we are about to see the Ancient of Days exercise his power and authority. Now, before we move on, I want to draw your attention to the very different pictures and scenes that Daniel has painted here for us. Scene one was full of chaos and a rough sea, and there were four beasts rising up out of it. And each beast was scarier than the last. Now compare that with this glorious and powerful depiction of a courtroom that has a wise and pure judge at the head of the table. He has power to right wrongs, and he brings justice and silences evil. Now, as we look at verse 11, we have a conclusion of these two scenes. I love how Daniel says here in verse 11, he says, "Then I continued to watch, because of the boastful words the horn was speaking." Remember, one of those horns rose up and took the place of three horns before it. And it had eyes like a human and a mouth, and it was speaking boastfully. I love verse 11 because of how Daniel uses the word "because." It's almost as if he stares in disbelief at this horn. After seeing the Ancient of Days on throne of fire, he almost looked in disbelief that this little horn would continue to speak such boastful words. Who could boast in the presence of the Ancient of Days? Imagine being in the presence of the Ancient of Days and speaking, let alone boasting. So Daniel goes on and he says, I kept looking until. The use of the word until here suggests that there's an expectation that something's going to happen. Like there's an expectation. I kept watching until. And well, what happens obviously happens. Keep reading. He said, I kept looking until the beast was slain and its body destroyed and thrown into the blazing fire. The fourth beast, the one that was most terrifying and actually too terrifying to even compare to an animal, with the swift and easy movement of the Ancient of Days, is slain and put into the fire. As for the other beast, have a look with verse 12 with me. The other beast had been stripped of their authority, but were allowed to live for a period of time. Even these three other beasts were subject to the rule of the Ancient of Days. He rules supreme over empires, kingdoms, and world events. He is in control, and he is good and just and righteous. A wonderful conclusion to these two scenes. Good wins and evil loses. And so, I ask the question again that I asked up front, church. What relevance does this have for us today? The Ancient of Days, four beasts, chaos. As we look back at the storm that was 2020, how does this passage of scripture apply to me and to you? In a year of lockdown levels, world disasters, and many personal losses, we can take comfort that God is in control of the storm and he has power over the beasts. When I think of God in control of the storm, I think of that wonderful passage where Jesus wakes up from his sleep and calms the storms. Another picture of why Jesus is God. God is in control. Now, this doesn't negate the losses. This doesn't invalidate our hurt and feelings, but rather it gives hope to our difficult situations. This doesn't invalidate any of that, but gives hope and speaks light and life into it. Trust that 2020 rests in the hands of the Ancient of Days. Trust that he comforts the mourning, he rights the wrongs, and he judges the unjust. Church family, what I want to encourage you as we round out this year that has been 2020, as we look back at the year that it was, I want to just leave you with this. Draw near to God. Find comfort in him. Look back at 2020 and take the year and lay it at the feet of the Ancient of Days. Open your Bible, read his word, speak to your Father who is God, who is the Ancient of Days. So church, what I want to do now is I want to invite you to simply sit back wherever you are, wherever you may be watching this, and I'm going to pray through some scriptures for us. And I want these scriptures just to bring peace to your heart. I'll finish it off with a prayer. But just sit back, close your eyes. I want to invite you to just be quiet in your heart. Maybe make sure your phone and all that kind of stuff is on Do Not Disturb. Bow your heads and close your eyes. So let's pray. Almighty Father, Ancient of Days, who was before the mountains were born, before you called the world into existence, God, you were. I pray, God, that you will bring hope into a year where it has been filled with brokenness. You would bring comfort into a world and a year that has been filled with losses. I pray, God, that you would comfort your people now as we read your word. Revelation 21, verse 4. He, God, he will wipe away every tear from their eyes. I'm going to say from your eyes. God will wipe every tear from your eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain. For the old order of things has passed away. Psalm 34, verse 18. The Lord is close to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit. Psalm 147, verse 3. He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. Joshua 1, verse 9. Have I not commanded you? Says God. Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. Romans 8, 28. And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. Lamentations 3, verse 31 to 32. For the Lord will not reject forever. For if he causes grief, then he will have compassion according to his abundant loving kindness. Psalm 9, verses 9 to 10. The Lord is a refuge for the oppressed, a stronghold in times of trouble. Those who know your name trust in you, for you, Lord, have never forsaken those who seek you. Psalm 46, verse 1. God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Almighty Father, I simply pray, O Ancient of Days, that as we look back on this year, these words, your words, may comfort us and remind us that you hold all things together and you will never leave us nor forsake us. We love you, O Lord. Thank you for the hope your word brings. We pray this in your name, God. Amen.